Hello and welcome to QTube. We are in the beautiful surroundings of Preston Park today. It's sunny and fingers crossed it's going to be sunny in a few days time for Brighton Pride, and that's what we're celebrating in QTube today. Doing a build up to the big day itself, having a look at the film festival that's running for a couple of weeks beforehand and finding out more about what's going on in the park. So with Brighton Pride just days away, we have the pleasure, the honour of being joined by Mr. Richard Jones, or as I know him, Dad.
Hi, son.
From Brighton Pride. We're not actually father and son. It's been like a running joke for years because we share the same surname. And I think
he introduced me in a gig as his dad. And it just went from there.
A number of times we have actually convinced people and they do think we're a bit close.
My Twitter profile actually says I'm officially your dad.
Oh, does it?
Yeah.
Oh, I need to get on Twitter more. So, Richard, we know you as DJ Richard Jones. You've been on the scene for years. You've been a staple of the gay community back before even I was born, probably.
Shut up.
All right. But now you've made the transition to Brighton Pride, so you're quite heavily involved with that now.
Yeah, I was asked by Dulcie and Paul, the directors, to come on board about 4 or 5 months ago, and I love it. I've got a massive passion for it. I've always enjoyed Pride. I love the intricacies of it, and from my background as a project manager, it's a really good thing to get in because there's so many different streams of work going on.
Yeah, and this year's Pride is shaping up to be the most diverse and exciting yet, isn't it?
It's going to be enormous. We're bringing back the live stage this year.
Yeah.
Great load of acts on there. We haven't decided... Well, we haven't released our listing timings yet, but
okay.
That's all going to be a little bit of a surprise.
Well, I've been wondering, because you've got the original Sugar Babes lineup,
yep.
You've got Alison Moyet, who else you got on
Paloma
there?
Faith doing a DJ set.
Yep.
Class A, boy band.
Yep, very attractive. First hand I've experienced them topless.
The Mend, I'm looking forward to meeting
yes.
one of them.
Yep, from the X Factor.
Yeah.
Okay.
And we've got a little diva section going on in the middle, which should be a great amount of fun.
Oh, I love a diva.
Yeah.
Right, okay, so that's the live stage. And then tents-wise, a lot of the old favourites returning.
Absolutely, so Wild Fruit dance tent.
Yep.
Then we have a women's dance tent.
Nice.
Women's performance tent. And then we have a Bears in the Wood area, which is quite a different format than we've had in previous years. It's going to be over there by the clock tower.
And is that where we can find you, Richard?
You'll find me there at about 4:15, I think.
Is that as a DJ or just as a customer?
I'll just be hanging around with the hairy chestnut.
Hanging around having a little teddy bear's
picnic. I will have my headphones on.
All right, cool, okay. And also, is the line dancing tent back?
Yeah, line dancing tent back, but later in the afternoon, because we're using the area as a dual purpose, so we're using it as a community village and then switching it over to line dancing tent.
Nice.
Because it's a bit of a wasted area later in the day, so we just thought we'd reuse that.
Okay, lovely. And of course, before the park, the kind of build-up to it is the huge parade through Brighton. Obviously, we're hoping for weather like this, but starts on Madeira Drive, doesn't it?
11 a.m. Madeira Drive.
Yep.
We have over 50 floats and walking floats.
Can we name some of the participants? Are we allowed?
We've got Brighton Bear Patrol, who are just going to do a world of Freddie Mercury's, which should be very, very amusing.
Awesome.
EDF are on board.
Yep.
Nando's. There are absolutely massive. The fire brigade are there, the police are there, the ambulance service are there as normal.
It's a great parade, isn't it? I think it's the best one we have in the city.
Yeah.
So it works its way along the seafront, up West Street, and then kind of weaves its way through London Road, doesn't
Absolutely.
It?
With about 100,000 people, we reckon, en route
watching
the parade.
And tickets-wise, what's the situation if people haven't got their tickets yet for the park?
If you haven't got your tickets yet for the park, if you live locally until next Monday, they're £12.50, and then they go up to £17.50. It's always best to buy online because you're going to get into the park quicker on the day.
Yep.
If you pay on the day, it's going to be a £20 note.
Right, £20 note. Nice. Okay, right, Richard, you're going to stick with us whilst we have a look at some of the latest LGBT headlines. So it seems apt as we're talking about Brighton Pride to give you some great news that you've probably heard about over the last couple of days. But the Equal Marriage Bill for England and Wales has once again been passed in the House of Commons, and it's soon going to be given royal assent to become law. I guess the timing of this can be better.
It
just sums up the whole vibe of Pride, doesn't
it? Yeah, the feedback we've had on Twitter and our Facebook page about that news is going to be amazing. There's a real sense of celebration about the event this year.
It feels like it's been a long time coming, and you know, without going into the politics of it, you have to go through various stages of the process, but we're almost there.
Yeah, we are almost there. It's just that final dotting of the I's and crossing of the T's.
The Queen has to sign for it.
Obviously.
Possibly, you know, of course. It seems apt that a Queen has to really sign for it, doesn't it? But really, on the kind of counter of that, you know, I think probably we should be glad that we're not in Russia at the moment because...
Yeah.
Horrible situation just emerging there about...
It's the Dark Ages.
It is.
It
feels like we've gone
ages.
Back in time. So if you haven't heard, basically gay propaganda has now become illegal in Russia. What it basically means is that no information on homosexuality at all can be given to children. It means that all gay pride events have been banned, all gay literature, and any sort of public display of affection between LGBT people also banned.
It's even foreigners.
Tourists.
Yeah, tourists could be arrested under that rule, which I just think is outrageous.
It does.
They're going to lose so much money. The massive load of LGBT people go to Russia every year on holiday, and they're just going to lose that money.
And it's such a shame, because you always think about Russia as being such a cultured place that it just feels like we've gone 50 years back in time.
We just need to bring the czars back now, and they've finished the job, I think.
I know, right? So from that then to another interesting story, and there's something that I've thought about in the past, but Maroon 5 singer Adam Levine, he's also a coach on The Voice over in America, the talent show. He's hit out at rival talent shows like American Idol and X Factor, saying that they actively discourage aspiring singers from coming out as gay. Now, it's something, I'm a big X Factor fan. I don't know if you are so much.
Not so much anymore.
You look at previous contestants and winners of the X Factor, and there's been quite a few who after the show have come out as openly gay. Yeah. So the likes of Will Young and Joe McElderry. And there's been times, particularly with Joe McElderry, during the show where in interviews they said, no, I like girls, you know. And it is, I think, you know, do you think producers behind the scenes are saying, you know, watch out, you don't want to lose the female vote?
I think essentially, yeah, the producers are around, and some of the judges, obviously with the judges, judges have a vested interest in the careers, maybe signing them up for a contract afterwards. Mm. They don't want to narrow the market that they're going to appeal to. So maybe if they were gay, they would be encouraged not to come out, because you're going to actually not get a section of the audience that you might have expected.
It's tricky to know how to get around that, though, isn't it, I suppose?
I think it's a time, especially when laws changing, it's a time to be honest with people.
Yeah.
And I think most of the kids that have come out from the boy bands, I don't think they're thought of any less than anyone else.
They've still done pretty well for themselves.
It's just very old school way of thinking.
Will Young's not complaining in his mansion in Hove, is he?
No,
he's done all right.
He's done all right.
Brilliant. So we talked about Brighton Pride. Now, one of the big parts of Brighton Pride this year, which we haven't touched on, is the build-up, the film festival. And we had a closer look at part of that, which is called Eyes Wide Open.
It's here, it's queer, and it's coming to a big screen near you. It's the first ever official LGBT Brighton Pride Film Festival. So grab yourself some popcorn, because the silver screen is turning pink. So Jonathan, you run the successful Eyes Wide Open events here. Can you tell us about that?
Yes, they've been running since last year, every single month at both cinemas. And they've been a mixture of rep screenings, documentaries, brand new releases, shorts, double bills. The inspiration for the programme was to never just have a film, for it to be an experience. So you'll have, where possible, an introduction and a Q&A, at the very least, some sort of handout or contextual introduction. Some of the screenings have been heavily academic, analysing a film into its core. Other times they've been late night shows with sing-along. We've had directors and producers down to make people experience the film differently and have an education at the same time.
Okay, so now you've teamed up with the organisers of Brighton Pride to launch a LGBT film festival in the 2 weeks running up to Pride weekend itself. How did this all come about?
So it was initially Paul Kemp that emailed the Duke of York's to say what was going on this year with Pride, that there was a more cultural side of the festival and they wanted to put some films on. And I intercepted that email and said, oh, hey, I'm already doing a queer film programme at these cinemas, so let's discuss the possibilities. And we had a few meetings over the months, decided how many titles, what sort of vibe we wanted to go with. And then, yeah, once I came up with a programme of events, sent it to them, green light, and then that was it, really.
Tell us about the shorts night that's happening during the programme.
Yes, that's on Thursday the 1st of August at the Dukes of Comedia, and it was by submission. So I put the call out for filmmakers to submit a short film on LGBT themes. And they range from about 3 minutes up to 25 minutes. And there's 8 or 9 films.
Breezers!
So one of the other important events that I'm really proud of is the one that coincides with Trans Pride. It's the first Trans Pride this year. And I can't remember how that came about, but we somehow found each other and decided to do a film, and that's going to be a film called Tomboy, which is a really beautiful coming-of-age French film. And before that, there'll be a couple of shorts, once again by local filmmakers, specifically about trans issues in Brighton.
So what's the feedback been like so far from people when they discover that this festival's happening?
Yeah, really overwhelming, actually. I'm quite proud that I've done it. So just to be able to say that working at the cinema and being able to use my position to put on a film festival is great. And the feedback from queer people in Brighton is great, and others and everybody that it exists. And I hope that it's the first of many in the next few years.
So eyes wide open there as part of the brand new Pride Film Festival, and we're joined in Preston Park by Torsten.
Hello, sir.
Now the Pride Film Festival is brand new this year, first year they've done it, and it feels like it was kind of a much needed part of Pride. It's a new dimension, isn't it?
Yes, I think lots of people in the LGBT community are going to be rejoicing about this added dimension to Pride, because the park's not for everyone, let's face it. So the film festival runs from the 24th of July until the 4th of August. And so during the whole Pride celebrations in the city, people can go and watch films that also show a kind of history of kind of gay liberation and gay activism, which is, of course, part of Pride, part of the reason why we celebrate it so much. So more people can feel included.
Yeah, some great films showing. If you do want to find out more, you can go to the Brighton Pride website. Now, another big part of Brighton Pride this year, as always, is the Women's Performance Tent. And find out more about what you can expect on the day and also the build-up to it, we send Al Start to find out more.
It must be that time of year again. I have brushed off my rainbow-coloured sweatbands. It's Pride. We're getting very excited. Tonight, we're having the Women's Performance Tent showcase and the pre-Pride fundraiser. Let's go upstairs and meet the bands, and let's find out why the Women's Performance Tent is so fantastic. Let's go. The amazing Mel Sanson, who is not only the front person of the rock band Kenelis, but she's also one of the organisers of the Women's Performance Tent. Yep. So Mel, welcome.
Thank you.
We've got an awesome lineup today, which you are part of.
Yes.
And I wondered if I could ask you first, as a performer, what does the Women's Performance Tent mean to you?
Well, it's really good exposure, I'm not going to lie, first and foremost. But I'm obviously a lesbian, and Pride actually means quite a lot to me. I think it's still a very important event that must continue to happen, just because some people are a little bit more okay with it. A lot of people still aren't. So, from a political point of view, it's important for me. And also, it's great from a fan point of view.
The lineup for 2013 is looking amazing. Are you excited?
I'm really excited.
It's come together like a beautiful plan.
Oh, it's brilliant. And all the acts that are performing are really happy to be performing. There's no divas involved or anything. It's just going to be a really, really exciting day.
So don't miss out. Be there. Zalus of the on your skin. Yeah. And maybe now we shall begin. Women's Performance Tent is awesome because when we first started, we were an unknown act, and you guys all took a risk on us, and we didn't have a CD when I was like, ah, but I promise you we can play. And they let us get on that stage, and we played Hands on Fire for the first time, and that's where we started. Now we shall begin. So that's it. I hope you've enjoyed that little taster, and I hope that's whet your appetite, and we'll see you at the Women's Performance Tent at Pride this year. There's a fantastic lineup of acts from 2 o'clock in the afternoon right through till the last second at 7:30. It's going to be amazing. Don't miss it.
So as it's a QTube Pride special, we should probably talk about just some of the dozens of events that are happening over the Pride weekend and in the build-up. And Torsten is going to help us do, as the man who knows all about what's going on in the city. Now, obviously, we could spend the next 45 minutes talking about it, but you've picked out some highlights.
I have. There are 20 big arty events happening in the 2 weeks up to Pride and over Pride weekend. I have picked out three. One of them, which is very exciting, is a big Keith Haring, the LGBT artist who was based in New York. The art exhibition is called Icons, and they're showing Keith Haring posters that have been donated by the Keith Haring Foundation, direct from New York. So the posters have been shipped over especially. It's at Brighton Library, Jubilee Street, from the 22nd of July to the 2nd of August, and it's well worth a look. Nice. Another one is a fantastic play called My Gay Best Friend, starring Louise Jameson from EastEnders. And
is Paris Hilton in it?
No. It's happening at Emporium, the new theatre on London Road. It's an award-winning play that mixes high camp, melancholy reflection on friendships and the childhood dramas that haunt us all.
Oh,
I know.
Sounds great.
It is really good. I happen to be involved with it as well.
Oh, cheeky plug.
Yes, cheeky plug. That's on Friday the 26th and Saturday the 27th of July, and you can get tickets from emporiumbrighton.com.
Okay.
And then, if you like walking around town and finding out about gay history,
that's me.
There's a walking tour called Camp Town, obviously based on Kemp Town.
See what they did there,
with local historian Rose Collis. It kicks off at 3 p.m. on the 28th of July on the seafront at Royal Crescent, and she's going to tell you all about Kemp Town Estate's queer history.
Okay.
You can get tickets and more info, of course, from rosecollis.com.
So that's in the build-up, and then of course we've talked about the park already, but there's club nights galore.
Yes, for people that like partying, there are loads of club nights. The official post-Pride party is at Shoosh on the seafront. It's going to be the biggest party of the night. It's the official party. And yes, the Pride dog show is happening as well. We're surrounded by dogs. Yes, the official party, it starts at 9 p.m. at Shoosh. There's a load of London DJs spinning their tunes. It's going to be amazing. And then if, you know, you're not too hungover, Sunday,
it's back.
It's back at the terraces.
Good stuff.
Not at the terraces, but on the terrace
at
Audio. That starts at 3 p.m. and goes on till late on the terraces, which sounds great. It's like Miami feel to Pride.
Mm.
And then later on the Sunday, there's the official Pride closing party back at Shoosh, where loads of fabulous things are happening. And then if you've still got the stamina, not sure I do anymore.
No.
Rebel is the Pride After Hours Club, which is happening at a venue to be confirmed.
Ooh, as mysterious.
As we go to print or broadcast.
Mm.
But you know, Rebel's always amazing.
Mm.
So get down there. It's going to be, you know, a night to remember, a good way to close off Pride. All tickets are available from wildfruit.co.uk and information at brighton-pride.org.
And where can we find you, particularly in the park? Are you going to be mingling in the cabaret tent?
There's so many tents this year.
Yeah, I know.
That I think it's going to be good to do a whole, you know, shoosh around the park.
Shoosh, I see. Mention the club name there.
Yes.
Are you sponsored by Shoosh?
I've got a t-shirt on underneath.
Yeah.
And then, of course, you know, the Wildfruit tent. It's fantastic.
Yeah, it's going to be awesome, isn't it? And of course, when it comes to the park, we are going to be all over it like a rash. QTube are going to be there. We're going to be broadcasting from all over the park. We're going to be having a look at how the women's performance tent comes out. We'll cover the Wild Fruit dance tent as always. And we'll just try our very best, because as you say, there's so many tents, to just give you a kind of overall idea of what's going on at Pride this year. But either way, it looks brilliant. Can't wait to see you there. As Torsten says, you can get your tickets and find out more information at the Brighton Pride website. Now though, it is time for another symposium.
Gentlemen, are you proud of Pride?
Oh.
Okay.
Proud of Pride?
Yeah, all those in favour?
I am proud of Pride for the fact that we have it every year and it's a great party in Brighton, but I find that there's a lot of shame at Pride. Like, you know, it can be incredibly debaucherous, and I've been involved in that, you know, being debaucherous on Pride, you know, getting really drunk at like, you know, 12 midday and getting even more and more out of my head and then doing some things that I really wasn't very proud of, but you know, I think, but in some ways, you know, I think it's a good party, and it's good that we have a just a balls out kind of, you know, gay pride day, way big, you know, float, procession and stuff go through, and that's wicked, and you know, loads of people from all over the world come down here, you know, and they go to all over the country, don't they, to all the different prides, yeah.
I moved to Brighton on the 1st of August, nearly 7 years ago, and I think it was like 2 days later it was Pride.
Oh, right.
And I'd only just come out, literally, as well, and I got to Brighton, and someone was like, oh, Pride, and I was like, oh, what's Pride? Didn't really know what that was, so I remember going down to, like, Preston Park and just being like... wow, brothers, sisters, yeah. This is great. So yeah. I think it had a real, it was a really wonderful experience to be like opened up to this whole world and realised there were so many thousands of people who were gay, lesbian, bisexual, transgender, yeah. whatever, all together and celebrating and having a party
yeah.
after so many years of being really repressed and not seeing any gay people
yeah.
anywhere
yeah, yeah.
in life, on TV, nothing. So
yeah.
for that, I'm always grateful for prides across the world because they do, they're very visual and yeah. there's lots of people mm. that really helps because they don't have that sort of
yeah.
in their day-to-day lives. Yeah. But yeah, it is like, Preston Park Pride Party is trashy and it's just drink and drugs and partying and it's not, as I think as we talked earlier, anything about nurturing like a beautiful queer spirit from within or anything like yeah. that. It is just yeah. like raucous fun, isn't it? But
I think for me, kind of Pride has lost its edge. Yeah. You know, they started as rallies against terrible kind of social injustices against kind of LGBT people. And now they've become, you know, a fuck fest, you know what I mean? A kind of massive kind of party that has, it's kind of degenerated to me into something that, you know, I don't really value. And I kind of, I've been to a few prides in Brighton, but I've always found them so intense and quite really alienating, intense,
yeah.
really.
Yeah.
And I don't think at Pride, the party, in particular on the park. Mm. I've never had any, I don't think I've ever had any kind of deep and meaningful connections with people that aren't above and beyond being drug fucked and, you know, just getting wasted and, you know, everything that goes with kind of, you know, what Pride is all about now in Brighton. Where I have had most kind of fun and a sense of connection and a sense of meaning have been really in queer spaces. So like the Cowley Club, for example, does an alternative Pride every year.
Oh, right.
And that's a different side of Pride to me, which is much more political.
Yeah.
It's about making a statement on the fringe of Pride, which isn't about kind of being dragged along by the consumer spectacle, which in many ways I feel it's become.
Maybe it's worth just drawing out of Brighton here as well in the context. I mean, there are gay prides all across the world and in countries yeah. where they're like the only thing, you yeah. know, you go to like Russia where they've had sort of gay prides
exactly.
and stuff.
Yeah,
and
yeah. I mean, yeah. that's, I mean, but yeah. I thought we were talking about Pride in Brighton really, but I agree with you, you know, the prides that happen in countries where...
Uganda.
Yeah, I mean, that was...
Heroic, though,
amazing,
isn't it?
Was I mean, that was heroic. That was fucking Pride, do you know what I mean?
Yeah.
But
yeah.
I do think that it's devolved slightly, kind of, you know, in this kind of... in an environment where perhaps we've been given some breathing space. Mm. I feel like it's been hijacked by something that isn't necessarily in our best interests. But I think just looking back on previous prides, like Winter Pride, for example, in Brighton was brilliant because, do you remember? Because they were just these lovely, like, autonomous spaces that kind of, you know, sprung up around the city where it was like a celebration of kind of queer culture in Brighton. And there were nice little activities happening that were funded from the kind of, you know, some of the profits from the Summer Pride the following year.
Interesting.
And I think that's really important. But I think above and beyond that, you know, for me, I mean, this is just my personal thing, you could lose the fucking big party because it doesn't interest me. And I'm sure, you know, it doesn't, you know, interest a lot of people that feel particularly vulnerable in those spaces. And you could do Pride on a much smaller, localised level, which is about celebrating community in a way where people actually feel...
Well, where they come together
held
as a community.
Held in the space, do you know what I mean? Yeah. And yeah, I think that's what Pride should be about.
Well, my experience is only with Birmingham and Bristol Prides. I've never been to Brighton Pride. But I can remember about 2 years ago, it was the Bristol Pride. And quite a large majority of my straight friends who were up for going and were in the city centre, they got up there and it was a good... these were students as well, and I can't remember the fee, whatever it was, between £15 and £20 or something like that, which was a lot for them. I mean, that's, you know, a lot more than a standard night out or whatever. Yeah. And that was immediately, you know, lots of friends that I would have loved to have come who were really up for going. Just had to pretty much go home and do something else. And the overall impression that year was of essentially just, you know, a private, you know, gig or a concert, you know, no different to, you know, any kind of summer festival that you could pay to get into. And it was, I know, it was a really disappointing year just to see, it didn't really fit into, it made it very elitist in that sense that it wasn't even in just an open kind of street space. Yeah. It was, here's this event that you need to pay to come into, where you can pay to buy some drinks and, you know, and pay to see some bands.
I think it's just, you know, it's a big carnival, isn't it, at the end of the day, though? Yeah. I think it's bright, it's colourful, there's loads of music, it is just a big party. And I think, you know, I think it's a good thing. I'm proud of it. I'm proud that it's there.
I definitely, like, I would want to see Pride happen every summer, you know. And I'm going to go to this year's and I'm going to have a good time, you know. It's going to be awesome.
We're going to be away.
Thank God.
We won't make it. Really? So you have to tell us all about it. We'll meet up and give us your, and it'll be your first one.
Yeah, this is the first Brighton one.
You can let us know what you think of it.